Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line.
As everybody knows, we are worried about the Philippines. To the end of doing something about what we are worried about, President Reagan recently dispatched his closest political friend, Senator Paul Laxalt, to discuss in Manila with President Marcos means by which the situation can be made better. There are differing reports about whether Senator Laxalt had any luck. Ferdinand Marcos has got used to running his own country, as viewers of this program with long memories will recall. President Marcos was our guest in Manila in 1978, and we haven't run the Philippines since 1946, when we gave it its independence. So what should we do? The trouble is of two kinds, one concrete, one less so. There is a communist army of about 12,000 guerrillas to worry about, and there is a whole lot of corruption combined with a democratic opposition that is less than robust. And they do not yet know for sure whether Senator Aquino was murdered on the instructions of a close friend of Mr. Marcos. Last spring, Representative Stephen Solarz, well known to viewers of this program, recommended economic pressure on the Philippines. Either Marcos would implement some reforms or we would cut our aid. In conference, his proposals were substantially abandoned, in part because of the way in which Mr. Marcos reacted to them. Mr. Solarz is the head of the subcommittee of the House Committee on Foreign Affairs that deals with the Philippines. He is a fifth-term congressman, a graduate of the Columbia Law School and of Brandeis University. Also a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee is Representative Henry Hyde, a Republican, a conservative, named as one of the six best congressmen in Washington by the discriminating Washington Monthly magazine. He will give his views on what to do about the Philippines. Mr. Hyde is also a lawyer, a graduate of Loyola University Law School, and before that, Georgetown. He came to Washington as a congressman after serving as majority leader of the 77th General Assembly of the state of Illinois. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Solarz, what in fact do we do if Marcos tells us to go fly a kite?
I think that would confront us with an extraordinarily serious problem, Bill, because pretty much everyone in Washington agrees that the situation in the Philippines is bad and it is getting worse. The administration itself has contended that if present trends continue, the communist-dominated guerrillas in that country may be in a position to take power by the end of the decade or sometime in the early 1990s. And the president himself has said to Mr. Marcos, I'm talking now about President Reagan, that in the absence of fundamental political, military, and economic reforms, the prospects for the future of that country would not be very bright. I think that what we need to do is not simply to urge President Marcos to make these reforms, which I think the administration deserves credit for doing, but to make it clear to Mr. Marcos that unless he's prepared to make those reforms, we're not prepared to continue providing the kind of support we've been giving him until now.
Why?
Because I think that without making it clear that our willingness to provide additional military assistance in particular is conditional on the enactment of these reforms, the chances that Mr. Marcos will make the reforms are virtually non-existent. And while there's no guarantee that he will make the reforms politically, militarily, and economically that are necessary if we make our aid conditional on the implementation of these changes, I think it's the only realistic hope we have for the initiation of reforms which are essential in order to prevent the eventual triumph of communism in that country.
Yeah, but you see, my question was, what should we do if he told us to go fly a kite? Even if I agreed with you that this was the best way to risk his undertaking these reforms, what if he says no? Does it really make sense for us to cease to send him arms when we know what the alternative is?
Well, it's a very good question. And I think the answer to it, first of all, is that there's a reasonable possibility, if we make such a threat, that the reforms might be made. Secondly, if they aren't made, as you hypothesize in your question, the administration itself has said that we could double, triple, or quadruple the level of our aid, and in the absence of fundamental reforms, it won't do any good. So I would say that in that eventuality, I think our interests would still be better served by withholding our assistance, because if nothing else, it would demonstrate to the people of the Philippines, who have long since lost confidence in the presidency of Mr. Marcos, that we are not prepared to continue propping up what is in essence a corrupt and discredited regime, which will put us in a better position in the long run to resume a more constructive relationship with the people of the Philippines when the Marcos regime is eventually replaced, as it inevitably will be.
Mr. Hyde, do you see any similarities between what we face in the Philippines and what we faced a few years ago in Iran?
There are some similarities. There are many more disparities. For example, the role of the church in Iran, the mullahs, can hardly be equated with the role of the Catholic Church in the Philippines. The reforms that we want Marcos to make are a return, a reversion to the democracy that for a while flourished in the Philippines, whereas the reforms that were being urged on the Shah went in the other direction. As a matter of fact, the Shah didn't get deposed because he didn't reform quickly enough. He reformed too swiftly and too much. So there are more dissimilarities than similarities. But I would like to comment on some of the things Steve has said. First of all, I don't think we can abandon the Philippines. Our stake in the Philippines, both traditionally and geostrategically, is much too important. Secondly, our aid isn't that much of a big deal to President Marcos. Total, $200 million, $70 million of which may end up as military, and it may not, depending on whether Steve has his way with the Appropriations Committee. Contrast that with $400 million military aid to Pakistan, $400 million economic aid to Pakistan, and similar amounts to Turkey. Considering how important the Philippines are to us, it is really no big deal. In addition, Mr. Marcos is in trouble. There are serious political, economic, and military problems in the Philippines, and reforms are urgent. But it hasn't reached the point of desperation that Steve says, if a poll recently taken in Manila by the bishops and businessmen, an alliterative group, but a very authoritative poll, which showed Marcos down in acceptance, approval of his work, from 47% to 44%. But the nearest moderate alternative, Mr. Laurel, was about 29%. But that is not to say reforms aren't urgently needed. But the question is, how do we get from here to there? Steve would withhold aid. It is my suggestion that Mr. Marcos is a very proud nationalist, and the better way to do it is to continue the pressure, which we are doing through various methods, PL-480, our aid with the international financial institutions, as well as our economic and military aid.
Well, I fully agree, Bill, with Henry's assessment of the growing seriousness of the situation and the need for reforms. But obviously, we do have a disagreement over how best to go about achieving the reforms. And here, I think the administration is certainly entitled to credit for having correctly understood over a year ago that the way for us to advance our interests in the Philippines was not to mindlessly prop up the government of Ferdinand Marcos, but to encourage that government to make some real reforms. One would have thought, for example, that given the Reagan administration's critique of our failures in Iran and Nicaragua, where they've argued that we were largely responsible for pulling the rug out from under the Shah and Somoza, leading to the triumph of alternative systems of government that clearly were neither in our interest nor in the interest of the peoples of those countries, that they would have assumed the best way to prevent the triumph of communism in the Philippines, which would not be in the best interest of the Filipino people nor the United States, would be to prop up Mr. Marcos. They haven't done that. Yet, I would submit, Henry, that The truth of the matter is that after a year of both privately and publicly encouraging Mr. Marcos to have free and fair elections, to eliminate the system of crony capitalism, to remove corrupt and incompetent generals who are kept in place not because of their military professionalism but because of their loyalty to Mr. Marcos, that after a year of trying this, we really haven't made much progress.
Well, Steve,
and the time has come to make it clear to Mr. Marcos that unless he makes these changes, we're not going to continue providing support to him.
Steve, in your seminal article in the New Republic last April, you conceded that the elections were fair in the Philippines in 1984 in from two-thirds to three-quarters of the district. Now, that's an improvement. There are remedies, there are corrective actions being taken in the economy. For example, the International Monetary Fund found enough agreement to loan $615 million to the Philippines. Not enough, but the point is that Marcos is reacting to pressure. The Aquino assassination was a disaster and hasn't played itself out yet. But this has to be done like brain surgery. You can't just tell them what to do. You can't topple a government. You can't pull the rug. At the same time, you have to work with every moderate force in the country because our position is one not of supporting Marcos, but of supporting the Philippine people.
I always assumed you were a subscriber to the National Review. I'm now delighted to find out that you read the New Republic as well, and I appreciated your comments
I'm very eclectic. But I follow your statements both in the record and publish those that are published very carefully, and I can quote some to you, and I may later on in the program.
And you often have on the floor of the House, but not in the context in which I originally presented them.
Let me say,
Henry, this is a perfect example, because in that article which I wrote on the Philippines in the New Republic, I did make the point that according to NAMFREL, the National Movement for Free Elections in the Philippines, which recruited 150,000 Filipinos, largely with the help, by the way, of the Catholic Church, to monitor the parliamentary elections there, they did conclude that the elections were reasonably free and fair in about two-thirds of the provinces. But they went on to say that there was such enormous corruption in the electoral process in the other areas that if the election had been truly free and fair throughout the entire country, the opposition, instead of getting a third of the seats, would clearly have won a majority.
Come to Chicago and we'll talk about election processes. But let me suggest to you that 13 was the number of opposition in the assembly until those elections, and it went from 13 to 59. Now, of course the elections weren't perfect, and there are lots of problems, but tell me that progress isn't being made. It is being made.
Well, I think that in certain areas, there is some progress, but the problem is that the progress is very limited, and for the great majority of people in the Philippines, the situation is getting worse rather than better. For example, you pointed out that the Philippines has reached an agreement with the International Monetary Fund. And it's also true that inflation has gone down from 60 to 10%.
100% last summer to 8% now.
But the fact also is that you have an unemployment rate in the Philippines of 35%, and when you add underemployment to that, it probably is over 50%.
Well, then don't you think the protectionist legislation that your party's advancing, such as the Jenkins bill, will wreak havoc on the economy of countries like the Philippines?
Yeah. That legislation, which I oppose, by the way, was passed with bipartisan...
Your party, you mean.
Cult of two or three
with
in your party.
With bipartisan support in both the House and the Senate. But let me say, Henry, that with respect to the economy, you have over half of the Filipino people living in poverty. And you're not going to get any real economic growth there. And by the way, while every other ASEAN country, Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, in the last several years has had dynamic economic growth, the Philippines is the only one where there have been negative rates of growth. Last year there was a decline of 5.5% in the gross national product in real terms. And the primary reason for this is because of the system of crony capitalism established by Mr. Marcos, in which he's given monopolies over sugar and coconuts and grain to close associates of him who have in effect extracted hundreds of millions of dollars from the poor people of the Philippines who otherwise would have been able to get a better price for their products on a free market by requiring them to sell their production to the monopolies.
Steve, you're
describing
the
problem. Unless he eliminates that system, there's not
going
to be any hope for the future.
We understand that, and what you say is absolutely true. But describing the problem isn't solving it. And the question is this administration appropriately going about pressuring the government to dissolve these monopolies? And it is my feeling and information that they are. Your cure is to just cut them off if they don't.
Since the House is not in session, may I have a word? In 1972, Marcos, who had been elected president in a free election, invoked a clause in the Constitution that was put into the Constitution, presumably as a similar clause was put into the French Constitution by de Gaulle, on the assumption that it might sometime be needed. When he did invoke plenipotentiary power, he was widely applauded. Widely applauded all over the world, because it seemed pretty clear that the alternative was anarchy. People were running for president with their own private armies. They were spending 10, 15 times per capita for a vote as we were here in the United States. Now, when I asked Mr. Marcos on this program 6, 7 years ago, why was it necessary to do that in the Philippines, he said, well, the Philippines, frankly, aren't ready for democracy. The United States did a lot of very good things, but they didn't plant the seeds of democracy quite deep enough. Now, you might say, okay, well, he was being cynical when he said that. But if he was being cynical when he said that, perhaps it's correct that he wanted to hang on to power, which he took at a moment when he was generally applauded for having done so. So I'd like to ask a question. What is it that we know about the Philippines now that gives us confidence that if it did have free and fair elections, it would proceed as a multi-party, pluralistic, democratic state, rather than head in a one-state direction, which perhaps would be taken over by the enemy?
There is, Bill, absolutely no guarantee that the restoration of genuine democracy in the Philippines would produce a permanent political paradise in that country. The original democratic system, which we bequeathed them, obviously broke down. But I think we can say with a degree of confidence that in the absence of a restoration of democracy in that country, the prospects for an eventual communist takeover there, which will prevent the reestablishment of democracy at any time in the future, are very good. And the reason for that is that the majority of the Filipino people have lost confidence in their own government. It is mired in corruption. It's run out of steam. There are enormous grievances throughout the country. And to the extent that the Filipino people come to the conclusion that the only alternative to the Marcos regime are the communists, support for the New People's Army, which is dominated by the Communist Party of the Philippines, will grow enormously. If the people of the Philippines, on the other hand, are given a democratic alternative to communism, I think that the legacy of democracy which we bequeathed to them, which is taken seriously by millions of Filipinos who do have a commitment to democracy, I think under those circumstances, there's a very real possibility that the communist challenge can be thwarted and turned back. So the alternative to communism is not a continuation of the authoritarianism of the Marcos regime. The most viable alternative to communism is a restoration of democracy, and I believe that is precisely the position of the Reagan administration.
You say you think that, and I would like to think it, but I don't know if I had to write a brief persuading people that this, in fact, would happen. I don't know where I'd go around collecting the data, because in the Philippines, you've got real problems we see all over the world. Over 75% of the countries of the world are single-party states. I just don't know what it is that makes you confident. Like your pal who runs Singapore, he doesn't have free elections over there.
Well, I think they do have free elections in Singapore, but the People's Action Party, headed by Lee Kuan Yew, because of the job which is done, has been able to win a substantial majority of the vote in all of the elections they've had. They've had only one party in power in Japan since the end of the war, the Liberal Democratic Party, but I don't think anybody would suggest that you don't have a genuine democracy in Japan.
Zimbabwe is moving towards a one-party government, and they had we hoped there was some democracy there, and so democracy doesn't always guarantee its continuation.
Well, you asked before, Bill, about the similarity between the situation in Iran and the Philippines, and I agree with Henry that while there are some similarities, largely resulting from the fact that in the Philippines today, like in Iran under the Shah, you had a corrupt government which had lost the support of the people. I think there are greater similarities between the Philippines and Nicaragua. And there what happened, which hasn't happened yet in the Philippines, is that when the people turned against Somoza, a point was reached where the private sector, the democratic opposition, and other elements opposed to Somoza, in effect, entered into an alliance with the Sandinistas. And you had a wall-to-wall coalition against Somoza within the country, where the only ones left supporting Somoza were his own family and the National Guard. In the Philippines, fortunately, the democratic opposition has not made common cause with the communists, because they recognize that if the communists come to power, the systematic repression which they're likely to impose will be far greater than the episodic authoritarianism of the Marcos regime. But if the current situation continues much longer, if people come to feel that the only alternative to Marcos is the New People's Army, at that point, the situation could become so hopelessly polarized that, in fact, a self-fulfilling prophecy is created and the communists become the only alternative to Marcos. And I think that would be a tragedy for the Philippines and a severe setback for American interests in Asia.
If I can intrude, the lessons that we all try to draw from these cataclysmic events may be different to different people. I think we should learn to have a coherent policy towards a problem. Now, in Iran, we didn't. We had Mr. Brzezinski saying, "Hang in there, Shah, we're with you all the way," while the State Department was arranging press conferences for the Ayatollah. In Nicaragua, Mr. Carter did not feel that he should be interventionist in the sense that he could help control events. We really had a non-policy, but one of trust me to the Sandinistas and the junta. So let's not make those same mistakes here. But then we get into very, very thin ice. So we cannot topple Mr. Marcos. We cannot appear to be too close to him, nor can we appear to be toppling him. We can't help the democratic opposition because the taint of foreign intervention is not welcome and can be counterproductive. But we must understand the problem and carefully use whatever leverage we have, and we do have leverage. And cutting off aid, cutting off military aid, deprives us of that leverage.
Henry, I hope you would agree that ultimately it was the Shah that lost Iran and Somoza who lost Nicaragua and not Jimmy Carter. Whatever the blunders in our
things may have been inevitable, except on the Shah. Right. I remember another lesson. Every revolution doesn't improve things. Yeah. And that, as some people have yet to learn, Steve.
Yeah, well, I think that's
said
a point.
Said he looking at Steve.
Oh, I think that's a point which is very well taken. Clearly, in Iran and in Nicaragua, the situation has gone from bad to worse. Although there have been countries where the elimination of authoritarian regimes.
And Cambodia, and Vietnam, and Cuba.
Can I finish it?
Sure. I just wanted to have a little more comprehensive list.
I know you believe in freedom of speech. Not only abroad,
do you?
But at home.
Do you?
Oh,
the Steve Solarz Show.
Which
we'll get in later, Bill. Go ahead, Steve.
Nobody has ever prevented you, Henry, from getting in your 2 cents worth. But the point that I wanted to make was that in Greece, where there was a transition from the authoritarianism of the junta to democracy, in Spain, which made a transition from the authoritarianism of Franco to the democracy which
exists today. And Argentina and Portugal,
right,
right. We didn't have a hyperactive policy.
Right.
We let things happen, and I'm suggesting maybe we should do that in the Philippines.
The point that I'm trying to make, Henry, is that when authoritarian regimes are replaced, it doesn't necessarily follow that the situation always deteriorates. There are times when it gets better.
I couldn't agree more.
And that's what we're trying to do in the Philippines.
You do distinguish between totalitarian and authoritarian then, I'm delighted to know.
In certain respects. But I think that that from our point of view, the major difference we seem to have is not over whether reforms are needed in the Philippines,
right,
but over how best to achieve them.
Precisely.
And here I think you have to recognize that one of the real problems we have as a country in persuading very gently Mr. Marcos to make these reforms is that almost without exception, the reforms we're asking him to make, were he to make them, would have the effect of reducing his own power. For example,
if
he had a genuinely free and fair election...
But he should live for history, and that's what we should be telling him. You can be a legend for centuries to come.
Well, I think
Simon Bolivar of the Philippines, and we should be appealing to his sense of history.
Okay, if and when it becomes clear that Senator Laxalt's mission has not succeeded in inducing Mr. Marcos to make these reforms, I hope it has succeeded. I'm frankly doubtful that it has. Perhaps we should send you as the next emissary so that you can, as eloquently as you've put it here, make exactly the same argument to Mr. Marcos in the Malacañang Palace.
I would insist the three of us go.
That might diminish the credibility of your representations and the effectiveness of your arguments. I think that you should be entitled to do it in private, with the full force and eloquence of which you are capable, and then we'll see what happens. But my guess is that he won't have free elections, because if he does, the chances are he'll be defeated. I think the only person in the country...
See, I don't think that's...
Let me raise an indelicate point, because it always sounds kind of gruesome, but still, history makes it almost a required hypothesis. The first question I asked General Marcos, President Marcos, on this program was, how is it... How do you account for your having said to an interviewer from Time magazine that the man you admire most in all this world, this was 7-8 years ago, is Mao Zedong? Well, he said that Mao Zedong really had a capacity for unifying his people. I said, well, of course, one way to unify your people is to kill everybody who doesn't want to be unified. Well, yes, there is that, of course. Now, it seems to me that Marcos really can be compared rather interestingly with Chiang Kai-shek. In 1949, we abandoned Chiang Kai-shek, in effect. And he was really not a very effective leader at that point, terribly corrupt. And there were factions all around him, and there was a lot of general chaos going on. We recognized a few years later, some of us did anyway, that it was a terrible, terrible mistake. We also recognize that if Chiang Kai-shek had exercised some of the discipline which, viewed abstractly, we despise, if he were 10 times tougher, for instance, than Marcos himself is, conceivably there wouldn't be 12,000 live guerrillas in his country. Marcos knew how to fight the Japanese. It was a very bloody situation. He knew how to fight the Hooks, another very bloody situation, and they sort of ceased to be. Now, what I'm saying is that history has an odd way of rewarding tough people when they assert themselves and take history by the reins and march their country in a particular direction, as, for instance, General Park did in South Korea. Now, even though that way is a bloody way, and I'm not here on record as approving it, I nevertheless remark this as an alternative we haven't considered, namely that Marcos should get much, much stricter than he is, and among other things, chop off some of the heads of his own cronies. Would we welcome that, or are we taking the position that there is nothing that can possibly save Marcos, given his own temperamental disabilities?
I think the problem that Mr. Marcos faces, Bill, is that he's riding a tiger, and he doesn't know how to get off of it, even assuming that he does want to get off of it. I rather doubt, frankly, that he does. And the real problem that we have in getting him to enact these reforms is that if he were to enact them, it would reduce his own power. And he appears to be much more interested in preserving his power than he is in saving his country from the fate which will befall it in the absence of fundamental reforms.
Why aren't we saying the same thing to Mexico? I can't believe there's more graft in the Philippines than in Mexico. I mean, that is inconceivable, isn't it? We've got a party that's been in power since 1927. We know from the last flirtation with elections that they were rigged. They've been rigged really now for two generations. We play along with the notion that Mexico is a democratic state. It isn't. But I don't see anybody saying, let's really put pressure on Madrid to move in on his cronies in the first place. Well, that would certainly solve the population problem in Mexico if one moved in on the cronies of the PRI. But somehow we baptize what's going on down there, and we say, no, let's just give more money. We give them $85 billion in the last two presidential terms. But why the difference in attitude there over against the Philippines? Is it because there isn't an organized opposition under the communist banner there?
I think that's one very significant factor. You don't have a revolutionary situation in place in Mexico in the way you now have it in the Philippines.
They can come real fast, those revolutionary situations.
And if and when it does, you can be sure that the existence of massive corruption in Mexico will be one of the factors contributing to the growth of the revolutionary movement. Although I must say that in the Philippines, one of the real problems is the extent to which corruption has, in a certain sense, been centralized in the hands of a relatively few people who are within the orbit of the first family. I used to think that President Mobutu of Zaire was someone who was extracting great wealth from his own country for his private pleasure, but I must say that compared to Ferdinand Marcos, Mr. Mobutu was a piker by comparison, because the government of the Philippines has literally extracted hundreds of millions of dollars, maybe billions, that otherwise would have been available for development and for economic growth in the Philippines into their own private bank accounts.
How do you know that, out of curiosity? I'm not necessarily disputing it, but how do you know it?
It's not something which I'm in a position to prove in court today in a way that would satisfy a libel jury. Although I would hope that if I'm sued for libel, that I come out of it as well as the Liberty League did in their your suit against them. But if you talk to any of the economists who study the Philippines, if you talk to people in our embassy, if you talk to the intelligence agencies of our own government, if you talk to Filipinos themselves, there are dozens of stories about how this goes on. And one of the ways has been through the use by President Marcos of these presidential decrees, which he has given himself the power to issue, which have the force of law, many of which, by the way, are secret, in which if somebody, for example, in the Philippines has a flourishing enterprise but isn't on good political terms with the president, by one of these decrees, can transfer the individual's assets to one of his own associates. He has established, for example, in the coconut sector of the economy, from which 30% of the Filipinos derive their income, a monopoly under the control of one of his closest associates, who has been in a position to set the price at which coconut producers are obligated to sell their production. For some strange reason...
I don't deny that he's plenipotentiary. I simply have trained myself to be a little bit skeptical about people who talk about these huge fortunes. You remember the huge fortune was a man's... that was accumulated by Key when he was running South Vietnam. Well, he's running a barber shop in Santa Barbara or something like that. So I don't know. Maybe they have $100 million.
He may not have invested his ill-gotten gains
well,
wisely.
Well, the point is, we're talking about a country of 50 million people, and that generates a certain quite a lot of wealth. And to suggest that the personal corruption of Marcos is sufficient to cause the impoverishment of those people is, I think, unrealistic. Well, there are other problems in the Philippines.
It's not just the corruption.
No, it's never just.
But it's also the system of crony capitalism, which discourages investment in the Philippines. Filipino businessmen are obviously reluctant to invest money in their enterprises if, by transforming them into a success, they run the risk that the enterprises will be confiscated by the government.
Steve, let me tell you something. My family were involved commercially in the Philippines for 30 years. We pulled out before Marcos became president, because doing business in the Philippines is a lost cause. They got a Supreme Court, which, as they put it, came in ab initio. There was no corporate law that they inherited from the United States. And under the circumstances, every decision they made, they understood as being binding for generations, with the result that they just w- were paralyzed. Now, this was just one family's experience in the Philippines. But what I'm saying is that I don't think it's by any means obvious that all of these Harvard Law School reforms that we all get so enthusiastic about will necessarily work in the Philippines. Now, this is not to advocate draconian despotism as an alternative, but it's simply to be skeptical that all these lovely things are going to happen if we stop sending them potatoes or whatever it is you want to stop sending them.
Well, I think the reforms that Steve has outlined are pretty well agreed upon. In terms of the military, we haven't talked about that, but there is a among the officer class a lack of professionalism as against a personal loyalty, and the present acting chief of staff, General Ramos, a West Point graduate, everyone concedes ought to be the chief of staff.
But
not
he's
just
insecure.
Acting.
He's very insecure.
He's very insecure because it is expected that General Vair will be acquitted and that Marcos is going to reappoint him, if only temporarily. But I think there are reform elements within the military. There's a We Belong group. There are some officers there who want to impose the leadership, the discipline, and the training. We know who they are, and they should be helped. A reform of the military, and President Marcos just put the civilian home defense forces under military command and is dispersing the authority. There are people there who can make changes. We have to find them and we have to help them without too much intrusion, and that is difficult to talk about on television.
Now let me ask you this. Why do we have to help them? I'm in favor of helping everybody we can help, but we also recognized that the formal end of Wilsonianism came somewhere along the line, and we simply can't impose democracy on Haiti, let alone on the Philippines. Now, I'm interested in Subic Bay and Clark Field. Why is it that with all the brains that we allegedly have in Washington, somebody didn't get around to instituting a Gibraltar-type, Guantanamo Bay-type relationship with Cuba, with the Philippines, before we turned it loose?
Well, for better or for worse, we didn't do that, Bill.
Okay, and we gave up our bases in Taiwan in 1979, cleverly and wisely.
That was real smart, wasn't it?
Yes, that was another great initiative of a preceding
Well, of course,
administration.
In Taiwan, we didn't quite have the levers that we had in the Philippines.
No.
But why did we do that? And question number one. Question number two. Are there circumstances under which that damage could be repaired, i.e., could we say right now to the government of the Philippines, okay, we've got a responsibility not to bring democracy to your country. We wish you well, but we can't do it for you. But we do have a responsibility to the Western Pacific, to 2-3 billion people who are dependent on traffic up and down the street here. And therefore, we can't fool around on the matter of this. So we make the following pledges. We want a 99-year lease, a Suez Canal type thing. Now, this doesn't mean that a revolutionary government couldn't attempt to defy it, but we could certainly hold our own.
We need a legitimate basis in
right.
there
right.
For the,
as we have
for the distant future.
As we have in Guantanamo.
You're absolutely right. We don't have that.
Why is there some pressure to get that?
I would hope there would be.
We call it the Hyde Codicil.
I will buy that and drink to that. 1991, the present lease elapses. It is fashionable to attack the lease and our presence there as foreign interventionism, but we are an important part of their economy. Some 43,000 jobs directly are employed at both of the bases there.
Well, there are a lot of derivative benefits to the Philippines.
It would be a disaster if we had to give them up, an absolute disaster.
Well, that's why I'm asking the question, why isn't attention being given to the jurisprudential problem and how it might be solved since we have an amenable government there now that is friendly to the United States? Now, he might say that's out of the question. I'd be hanged tomorrow by the Philippines if they understood me as ceding sovereignty here. But the effort could be made, and it could be represented in the form of a guarantee to the Philippines, i.e., as long as we have our bases there, we have certain reciprocal obligations to the Philippines, which we would enter into. What's the matter with that approach?
Well, I think you put your finger on the problem with it, Bill, which is namely that it would not be politically acceptable within a Filipino context, and certainly not at the present time. And I don't think, therefore, there's any real chance that the present government, or for that matter, any future government in the Philippines, would agree to give us a lease of that duration on the bases, although from our point of view, obviously, it would be helpful. I think that we really face two potential threats to our continued access to Clark Field and Subic Bay. And I fully agree with Henry that these are very important military facilities. There are our largest bases in the world, and they make an important contribution to our ability to preserve the peace and maintain a balance of power in Asia. If we were obligated to leave those bases, it would send shockwaves throughout the region. And there are many countries in Asia, like Japan, Thailand, Australia, and others that depend on the United States for their security, that would be deeply concerned if we didn't have access. So clearly, we have a real American interest in preserving our ability to use these facilities. I see two problems. First is that in the long run, our ability to remain there depends on the willingness of the Filipino people.
No, it doesn't. Not really.
Oh, it certainly does.
No, it doesn't. It didn't in Cuba, and God knows it didn't in Spain for the British. Well, they weathered that whole storm that Franco kicked up, and they just plain survived it. If you're saying that we don't have the strength to hang on to Clark Field against the Philippines, then we may as well give it up in the first instance.
You may long...
It's much better to do it in hospitable circumstances, better to do it than not do it at all.
You may regret the fact that we gave the Philippines its independence, and that it's no longer a colony of the United States.
I don't regret it.
It is a sovereign government. And in Cuba, we had previously negotiated the kind of arrangement we did with Guantanamo. For better or for worse, we didn't do that with Clark and Subic, and therefore, our ability to do so now depends on the willingness of the Filipino government to agree to those arrangements.
Okay, well, I'm saying let's come up with a package in which it is obvious that we're acting in good faith. So if we were interested in imperialism in the Philippines, we wouldn't have given them their independence in the first instance. So we got pretty good a pretty good pedigree here. Number two, it's costing us a lot of money every year to run these bases, and the benefits flow directly by economic means into the Philippines and indirectly for geopolitical leverage that we have in that part of the world. Number three, we are in a position to make an offer that would be coterminous with the length of that lease. For instance, we could say we will sign a mutual non-aggression pact with the Philippines. For all I know, we still have one.
We have a mutual defense treaty, which goes beyond the non-aggression pact. But Bill, you remind me of someone who owns a home right on the ocean where a hurricane is about to blow it away, and they're talking about how they can build additions to the home in order to make some more space for some of their relatives. I mean, the real problem we have in the Philippines is not figuring out how to get a 99-year lease on Clark and Subic. The real problem we have in the Philippines is figuring out how to prevent the communist takeover there, which would clearly result in the loss of our access to Clark and Subic.
To which my answer is, we don't know how to keep the communists out, but we do know how to hang on to Clark and Subic.
We might be able to do both.
I'm all for doing
sure, both. With an appropriate package of economic aid, assist them in their balance of trade problems, maybe even some immigration understandings, but help them. They have a major economic problem. Let's help them with their economic problem, in exchange for which we get a better lease on those two installations.
Well, Henry, I would certainly be prepared to support a kind of Marshall Plan for the Philippines in which we substantially... In which we substantially increase the level of our aid in the context of a commitment on the part of the government there to make the kind of reforms which would enable them to utilize the aid effectively. I hope you would agree, however, because this has clearly been the position of the administration, that in the absence of across-the-board political, economic, and military reforms, even the existing aid we're giving them will not make a difference, and an increase certainly wouldn't make a difference.
No, I don't agree. I don't think we can cut the present minimal aid that we're giving to the Philippines, both militarily and economic. First of all, our military aid is confined to communications and transportation, something they desperately need in their stalemated struggle against the communist forces. We can't just pull out on that, or we're guaranteeing that we lose.
That wasn't my question. My question was, do you agree that in the absence of fundamental reforms, the aid we're giving them won't do any good?
No, I don't agree. I think, first of all, there will be reforms. There are reforms. We have to continue to have leverage. If we pull the aid out, if we pull it out, we'll have no leverage, and we can guarantee the communists will prevail.
Well, obviously, you're entitled to your opinion, but you are clearly at this point in disagreement with the administration in the sense that they have testified before my subcommittee at hearings at which I think you've been present that without real reforms, the aid we're giving will not be used effectively. Now, they believe, to be sure, that by giving the aid, we have a better chance of getting the reforms.
Steve, we're fighting for time, too, over there. There's going to be an end to the Marcos regime. And you can't suddenly get very activist and pull aid out because the reforms aren't immediately being implemented. You have to see what's going to happen next month and next year and the year after. So you do the best you can with what you have to work with.
I'm telling you, Henry, that the handwriting is on the wall. If the present trends are not reversed...
Well, now, if the present trends, sure, I agree with you, but the present trends may well be reversed because of the behavior of the Philippine people, events that occur within the Philippine nation itself, as well as our continued keeping of the pressure on, which we're doing.
Well, this is, I think, where we obviously have a fundamental difference. We have tried to induce the government there for the last year to make real reforms, and the only changes that have been made have been essentially cosmetic ones.
We demanded a fair investigation of the Aquino assassination, and we got one. Now, we don't have a trial yet that we can point to and say is fair, but we got a fair investigation. We've had decent elections by their standards and even by ours. There is still a free press over there, not as free as we want it, not access to television. There have been economic reforms with the International Monetary Fund. There's a lot of things.
There's a free judiciary, too.
Since I permitted you without interruption to make your case, will you permit me without interruption to respond?
Okay.
We're making progress.
If you really want to, okay.
You can't speak to me, by the way.
Well, I am surrounded here by Genghis Khan and Attila the Hun. But if I may respond to what you said, Henry, first of all, with respect to...
Go ahead, Mao.
Yeah. With respect to the investigation of the Aquino assassination, you're absolutely right. The investigation itself was independent, and it was far better than most people would have anticipated. But the trial has become a farce. The court has thrown out the evidence which was submitted against General Vare. Everyone in the Philippines not only anticipates that General Vare will be acquitted,
Steve,
but as
I hate to interrupt, but I can't let the Miranda rule... Well, I'll forget it. Go ahead. You finish, and if I remember, I'll bring it
up. The bottom line...
I'll remind you.
All right.
We're talking about Fabian Vare now.
That's right, and the Miranda rule, which we prize and sanctify, which they use to throw the evidence out.
There's a fundamental difference between the right of an accused person in a police station in our country to be warned that his testimony may be used against him, and the extent to which in the Philippines Mr. Vare's testimony, not in a police station, but before a panel of inquiry, constituted the basis of the evidence against him because of the degree to which he completely contradicted himself on numerous occasions. In any case, the bottom line is that the people of the Philippines have lost confidence in the effort to bring the murderers of Ninoy Aquino to justice, and this has further alienated the population and discredited the government. You talked about reform.
I think that's probably true. And I don't think you'd dispute that, would you?
No, although...
That was the dumbest thing. I mean, if Marcos had a hand in it, then he's stupid, which I never thought he was, which is why I don't think he did have a hand in it. But I think probably some of the royalists who surrounded him probably did.
Yeah,
It was a catastrophic event in terms of Marcos's career.
Precisely. And if General Vare is acquitted based on the information that everybody knows, I think there'll be very serious consequences. And this is something Marcos has to understand, and I think Senator Laxalt made that point along with several others.
And what do you think we should do, Henry, if General Ver is not only acquitted, but if President Marcos reinstates him over our objections as Chief of Staff?
I don't think we should cut off all aid or attempt to ameliorate the situation, and I think you do.
What do you think we should do?
I think we should express our great concern privately. We should continue to work with the moderate forces within the country, and we should continue to try to point out to Mr. Marcos he is heading right down the chutes if he doesn't make these reforms.
But we
have nothing else to do. What would you have us do?
Here is the essence of the difference between us, and that is, from my point of view, since the reforms we're asking Mr. Marcos to make will have the effect, as I think you conceded, of diminishing his power, the only chance we have of getting him to make those reforms is if we confront him with a situation in which he concludes that the price he will have to pay by not making the reforms exceeds the consequences of making them. And if we limit ourselves to private representations in which we urge him to do the right thing, but which are not backed up by credible threats to diminish the level of our assistance, the chances that he will cooperate are virtually non-existent.
Well, we have other leverage. For example, in PL-480 funds are some $40 million of that. We can slow the payouts. There's leverage with the Asian Development Bank, the World Bank. We can veto loans to him. There are many ways to put pressure on that aren't public and that can be effective. And we just have no right to decide these questions for the sovereign government of the Philippines.
I think you are absolutely right in suggesting that there are a variety of potential sources of pressure that can be brought to bear on him other than the American military and economic aid programs. But what I think we ought to do is not simply threaten to reduce the level of our aid. I think we ought to try to organize and orchestrate a series of pressures on Mr. Marcos from the private banks, from the regional development banks, from the other donor countries.
I think we're
doing
that.
In which all of us go to Mr. Marcos and say, in effect, that we think these changes need to be made. We're not going to continue investing in policies that are leading to disaster. And our willingness to continue providing the assistance will be a function of his willingness to make specific reforms. For example, we might ask the banks to say that their willingness to reschedule the hundreds of millions of dollars in loans which are coming due would be a function of his willingness to eliminate the monopolies and to stop the system of crony capitalism.
Well, that's a little visionary. Banks have to do what they can do. Not to fulfill our foreign policy, but to save their solvency. And you can't tell a bank not to reschedule if there's no chance of them ever getting their principal or interest.
But I think the banks are beginning to recognize that their ability to get back their investments in the Philippines depends on a fundamental improvement in the political situation in that country. Because without it, people aren't going to be willing to make the investments which will generate the economic growth from which the Philippine government will get the resources to pay back the loans.
Senator Kerry, who is not an arm of the Reagan administration, in his very interesting report said that Ambassador Bosworth, in his opinion, is exerting the right sort of pressures to accomplish the right sort of goals on the Marcos administration. So take some consolation from the fact that something's being done over there.
I think Ambassador Bosworth is one of our finest diplomats, and I think he's doing a magnificent job. And I think the administration deserves credit for having sent Senator Laxalt over to Manila in order to let President Marcos know that it wasn't just it wasn't just liberal congressmen like Steve Solarz or mid-level bureaucrats like Paul Wolfowitz or Richard Armitage who were concerned about the situation in the Philippines, but President Reagan himself, because apparently Mr. Marcos, who is increasingly isolated and who to a certain extent is beginning to live in a dream world, was under the impression that President Reagan didn't share the concerns that had been expressed by the Congress and by the Department of State and the Pentagon. Now he knows, and we'll see as a result of the Laxalt mission whether any of these reforms are made. But, you know,
they can't be made immediately. because it can't appear that he is succumbing to direct pressure from the White House. But the message was received. I'm confident Senator Laxalt believes his mission was successful, and I think we'll see some changes in time. Let's both hope so.
Well, I certainly do hope so, and I think it ought to be given a chance to see if it works. But if it doesn't work, and I frankly fear that it won't, then I think we have to be prepared, if only in order to protect our own interests in the Philippines.
To do what, Steve?
To adopt a new strategy, and because the existing strategy isn't working.
Which is
to make it clear to Mr. Marcos that if he wants our help, the help of the banks, the help of other countries, he has got to be willing to make these changes.
You speak with this divine conviction that making clear to Marcos is the equivalent of restoring pluralistic democracy in the Philippines. I don't see any reason whatever to suppose that the one follows the other. We did all the things you're talking about for quite a while, and the Philippines degenerated into a situation in which martial law became inevitable and, in fact, welcome.
Well, you know, Bill,
I have no reason to suppose it'd be different beginning tomorrow. Now, this doesn't mean that this is the politics of despair, but it means that it's a politics that simply is skeptical about the kind of
utopia. He has greater leverage over us than we have over him.
That's why I talk about Subic and Clark and some kind of a deal that weathers all these storms. You have 30 seconds.
Well, over a million Filipinos gave their lives during the Second World War resisting the Japanese occupation
in a war
of
which Marcos was a singular hero.
Absolutely. But they gave their lives because they believed in the ideals which we had bequeathed them, and because they wanted to enjoy the benefits of
they were invaded by the Japanese.
So were other countries in Southeast Asia that didn't resist the way the Philippine people did. And I think they deserve great credit for the resistance
What did the Russians under Stalin give their lives for?
For the fatherland. Not for democracy, for the fatherland. But in the Philippines, it was different.
Thank you very much, Congressman Hyde, and thank you very much, Congressman Solarz. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations: Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.